suspended.
Good evening, I'm calling the meeting to order at 7 o'clock. We have a roll call, please, Ms. Shepherd.
Butters?
Yes.
Here. Strauss?
Yes, here.
Mia Lepash?
Here.
Weeks May?
Here.
Toomey?
Here.
President O'Donnell?
Here.
Thank you.
All right, just as a reminder, this evening, our sound for the recording is being done on the camera's microphone, so however we amplify ourselves is the best we can do even here in this media center space. So be aware of that. So good evening, this is a meeting of the Ferndale Public Schools Board of Education held on Monday, August 17, 2015. Our meeting is being recorded for broadcast on cable and the district's YouTube channel. All meetings in Ferndale Schools are held in public in compliance with the Open Meetings Act. Documents discussed in tonight's meeting are available to the public on the district's website or on request, with the exception of any information protected by student or employee privacy rights. The website address is ferndaleschools.org. If you don't have internet access and need a packet provided to you, please call the board offices at 248-586-8652 by Thursday of the week prior to the meeting, and district staff will do their best to assist you. So let's please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
To the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This past week, Ferndale Schools lost one of its longtime employees, a parent and grandparent to past and current employees. And I want to just take a moment of silence in memory of Dr. Lawrence Sophia and his family. So we can just pause for a moment to remember Dr. Sophia and keep his family in our thoughts and prayers. Tonight's agenda. Yes.
I wanted to suggest that we move item 8, Eagle Points of Pride, up an item before item 7.
Sure. Makes sense to me. Hearing none, without objection, the agenda is approved. Next item on the agenda is public comment, and please forgive the beeping noise that you hear. That's a problem with our alarm panel, but everything's fine. It'll periodically go on. So just as a reminder for public comment, you can comment on agenda items or non-agenda items with a time limit of 3 minutes. If there are more people who wish to speak, then we'll fit into a half an hour. We will add time to the end of the agenda before the closed session to allow more people to comment. So the usual guidelines, I think there's nobody brand new to a meeting here today. So. Just line up at the podium behind Mr. Tullisford.
Good evening. My name is Maurice Tullisford. I'm the president of the Ferndale Education Association. Just a few updates. We spent quite a bit of time over the summer working with the administration to find ways to contribute from our union to help the financial situation of the district. It was nice to finally be invited to participate in the conversation and just have a seat at the table as opposed to being dictated to. And I think going to our members, it's never good to present concessions, but it'll be nice to say we at least collaboratively discuss these and reach these concessions for the year. So that's one. Two, I think our union is going to make a bigger effort to do some sort of icebreaking with the administration and get to know them better, to build more trust on both sides through our leadership team and their leadership team. And I wanted to extend an invitation to the board that if you'd like to join in or sit down and have coffee with any of our leadership team, just to sort of get to know each other, I think that'd be a good thing moving forward. If we ever encounter a crisis, I think having better relationships to rely on will help us work through that together and sort of just talking at board meetings. And then the third thing, September 17th, our union is working with other unions in the area to do a showing of a movie about the privatization of education. We're going to host it here at the FHS auditorium. We're inviting many other local education associations as well as congressmen and other elected officials and experts in education to sort of do a panel Q&A after the movie so that everyone's aware of what Lansing's doing as it relates to education and the direction they're moving. Thank you.
Yes. I just wanted to mention, I just saw that movie the other night with Mike Davison, who's now running the Grassroots Network site. And so I think if you're interested, you would be excited to maybe team and help.
I'll email you to get his contact number. Okay. Good reviews on the movie, or is it worth it?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Anyone else? Seeing no one coming out of the podium, we will close public comment and move to the consent agenda. Just as a reminder, the consent agenda is for routine business items where no further discussion or questions are needed by the board. Any one board member may pull something off the consent agenda and have it added to item six on the agenda, which is consideration of consent agenda items that are pulled. Have a question and discussion at that time. Tonight's consent agenda items are 3.1, request to approve minutes, 3.1 through 3.3, request to approve minutes of special meetings on June 15th, June 26th, and July 20th. Item 3.4 is a request to approve the bills and accounts. 3.5 is a request to approve resignations and new hires. And item 3.6 is a request to approve the 2015 to 2016 board meeting minutes. Anybody wish to pull off an item?
I would request that we pull off 3.6 so that we can talk about meeting dates. That question about a couple of them.
Okay. Any other items? All right. So I will entertain a motion then to approve consent agenda items 3.1 through 3.5. Moved by Mr. Deegan-Kraus and seconded by Ms. Leakes-Bain. And maybe we have a roll call, please.
Butters?
Yes.
Deegan-Kraus?
Yes.
Latash?
Yes.
Leakes-Bain?
Yes.
Toomey?
Yes.
President O'Donnell?
Yes.
Thank you.
And that motion passes unanimously. We'll move on to the action agenda items now. Item 4.1 is a request to approve the resolution for the school bond loan fund.
I'll give
a long block, which is my fault. The podium used to be back then.
Our district annually participates in the school bond loan fund, which is obtaining a loan from the Treasury Department to help to pay off our debt of the district. This loan will not go on in perpetuity. We take the loan for a number of years, and then eventually we reduce the amount that we borrow, and then eventually we pay it back until the bonds are retired. So I'm requesting that the board authorize this resolution. We are looking to borrow this year an estimated $503,000, which is a reduction from last year.
Okay. So I'll entertain a motion to approve that request. Moved by Ms. Toomey, seconded by Ms. Latash. Any discussion on the motion? Hearing none. A roll call, please.
Deegan-Kraus?
Here. Yes.
Latash?
Yes.
Leakes-Bain?
Yes.
Toomey?
Yes.
Butters?
Yes.
President O'Donnell?
Yes. And that motion passes unanimously. The application is approved. It needs to be signed by the secretary, so Kevin and Blake, a superintendent. And it also says type of print, name of treasurer, but there's no signature on it. Item 4.2 is a request to approve school board committees. School board committees, actually, so I would like to read that, for 2015-2016. And Mr. Pruitt will introduce that item.
This one worked with governance committee. Excuse me, I need to get logged in here for a minute.
Okay.
There we go. Looking at a committee model regarding the school board business. We moved last year governance sustainability achievement to match the strategic plan, as well as we started marketing and we started a number of restructuring committees. So there actually was an email chain throughout the entire county of every school district, what their committee structure is, if they had a committee structure, how it was devised. So in conversations of looking at best practices, looking at what the needs of the district are at the time, it was looking at keeping a similar structure but expanding some opportunities. So the first committee would be governance. And this is generally our policy. This committee advises the board on policy, board operations and structure. It's really the business of the board. Since the board is one of the main tasks of a board is adopting policy. It's in the same structure, two board members, board president, superintendent, assistant superintendent, human resources. Looking at the second committee, which encompasses our strategic plan, and this was also looking at best practices in finance within the county and within the state. This committee provides direction and oversight for the district's asset management and planning. The committee monitors budget reports, reviews facility and site utilization, and provides input on both financial and facilities planning. Anything that happens within our facilities deals with finance. It has to deal with expenditures of money. So we shouldn't keep expenditures separate. Everything should be part of the whole. We're looking at this committee, and we did this committee last year, starting in December as a committee of the whole, as we're looking at the restructuring and looking at all that. The recommendation from the governance committee is that we go back to this as a separate committee. Once again, these meetings are open to the public, unless there is an issue with governance regarding staff where it would have to, for legal reasons, go into a closed session. So this committee comprised of two board members, superintendent, assistant superintendent, and the committee recommended two additional community members with the following type of experience. One that would be a member with some type of financial background in order to understand and assist in working with the school budget. Although we have different levels of understanding on the board, and we do have Nancy and her team, they have a community member that would have a different perspective of finance to be on that committee to help advise the board. And also looking at finding a community member that has some background facility or operations in order to help advise the running and upkeep of the district facilities. So if someone with that operational facility background also. And those are some pretty wide open parameters, but trying to get some community members. It also allows community members to get a better understanding of the functioning of the board, as the board is, you know, members of the community. The Achievement Committee, which deals, and I'm going to rewind for a second. Within the role of the board, the role of the board within finance or sustainability is the approval of the budget and the oversight of the implementation of the budget. So these specific committees are geared towards the functioning of the board by law. So the third within achievement, by law, the board is to approve curriculum, approve expenditures for textbooks. So this area covers those areas that the board must approve. So the board has background education knowledge of what the board is approving. The committee provides direction to the board regarding educational priorities and goals. Programs and materials to achieve goals are reviewed with recommendations then being made by this committee to the board. Board to be comprised of two board members, Assistant Superintendent Curriculum Instruction, and two community members with the following backgrounds. A parent of an elementary student with some form or experience in education and knowledge of education, and a parent of secondary student with experience and or knowledge of education. The next committee is not something that is necessarily an official function of the board, or some things that would come forth the board to vote on, with the only exception being school of choice. But this is something in the strategic plan that was mentioned regarding making sure that we have a secure marketing communication plan with the community and regarding enrollment. And this is one that we started this last year. This committee provides advice to the communications department regarding public relations and district communications. Committee is comprised of one or two board members, director of communications, and two community members with the following background. And Mr. Good has made the recommendation that that could be expanded to other community members depending on the need of the time. We find that we need someone with a specific background in advertising or within public relations or even within the city or the DDA, Chamber of Commerce, depending on what we're working on. So looking at people that have experience in public relations or communications, we'd like to have a better link to our local businesses, to especially our downtown and our city. I have been a board member of the Chamber of Commerce, which there have been some things that I've been able to do that have helped our students, internships, some scholarship opportunities, the art prizes that were done earlier this year. But looking at trying to engage those businesses more, to engage that part of our community and be part of that public relations. So within here, we're looking at some ad hoc committees. One of the ad hoc committees of the sustainability would be a sinking fund exploratory committee. We know that when our bond is up, the only other avenue that we have of having capital to expend on our buildings would be a sinking fund. So looking at if that's a need, and if that is, then making that recommendation to the board. But looking at myself, Assistant Superintendent of Human Resources, and Mr. Shelton has also taken on operations this year, so that would be an area that he would be at. Three board members and following community members. Member of sustainability, preferably the person that has experience in facilities. A parent from each of our Ferndale K-12 programs. Hopefully a community member of some level of construction or facility experience. Elementary and secondary administrator and a local business member. So that would be a wider committee that had more voices on it so we can make that determination. Once again, all these meetings are open to anyone in the community at any time. The restructuring committees, currently we have an open classroom committee, a professional development, curriculum committee, logistics committee, communications committee, and then we'll be starting a middle school transition committee that Mr. Gillespie will be running. And these committees have generally will continue to have an open enrollment structure where anyone from the parent is welcome at any time to be an active part. It's really just a forum to talk about what's going on, get ideas, making sure that we're addressing the concerns of the community. We were looking at accepting applications up through September 20th, and if the board were to approve this, to start actively recruiting from the community, people that would want to be part of the different levels of the committees. And just a reminder to the board members in looking at best practices, many school districts do either a committee of the whole or just have one or two committees. Some of our local districts actually do closed committees where no one is allowed to the meeting except board members and administration. This board has made it very clear that we are transparent, that every meeting is open, unless legally we cannot. So we are doing something different than other districts in terms of keeping our meetings open. We also have already set a schedule that's in your board packet so we can make sure we get those out early and we keep to it during the course of the year. That allows people to know well ahead of time. We're also doing those meetings in the evening where other districts actually do them during the school day, but those same districts that do them close. So in the structure, we're looking at trying to engage community members,
that want to learn more about the board and become more of an active part of the district from a community aspect, as well as making sure that the board has the information that it needs in order to make its decisions. So that is, it's generally the recommendation both of the administration and the governance committee.
Does anyone on the governance committee want to add anything to that? All right. Just briefly, one thing that I wanted to append to that really is in terms of participation, we want to make sure that, again, we're really underscoring the fact that the committees that are the hottest issues, which are always have the most open participation. So right now, that's the restructuring process. And then what will become a big issue is the sinking fund exploratory committee, because we want to make sure that we have a way to add to our operations, our facilities operations within the law and within what we're allowed to do, which is a way of financing that outside of the general fund. So that committee is going to explore what exactly, if anything, we need there. And then on the other committees, we are expanding them so that from just board members to people, you know, what we talked about was very targeted individuals that will help us, help advise us on topics that Blake mentioned. And the other thing I wanted to mention was when it comes to open meetings. So none of these are decision making. The board isn't delegating any decisions to these committees. So I know our bylaws specify that committees are subject to the Open Meetings Act, which is the law when they have delegated authority or they make decisions that require deliberations toward a public policy decision. These will not be those types of committees, so we'll continue to do all those deliberations and decision making here. So when they are closed because of sensitive issues, they may be closed for sensitive issues outside of the strict requirements of the Open Meetings Act because they're not subject to open meetings.
But every decision the board will be discussed at a board meeting in open.
Right.
The bodies make no decisions.
So there's no votes being taken in these committees either. And then also, the board has from time to time, just for disclosure, a couple of board members from time to time will meet with Mr. Pruitt, Kevin and I did, just to talk about some election issues last week in terms of what the district needed from a committee, from a millage committee, a political, millage political committee. So that's going to continue to happen also. But again, those are not vote-taking committees mostly. Sharing.
And as the board expressed last year, they wanted to make sure that they had as much information in the decision-making process, which is why we went to the committee of the whole, especially with the restructuring. So what I heard from governance was a need to dig deeper, and that needs to be within more of a committee structure, so then that can be brought back to the whole group to discuss. So that purpose of the committees is really to be advisory to the board and to make sure the administration is bringing forth the material that the board wants in the time of hand.
So something that we did talk about in the governance committee that I wanted to pass along to the other board members is one of the disadvantages of having, you know, more committees is it requires more time of the staff. And so I wanted to point out one sort of adjustment we did make, and you've probably noticed it in the committee meeting schedule, is that the governance committee and the sustainability committee will both meet Monday night. And that was, you know, in an effort to sort of shorten it a little bit, not shorten the meetings, but to make it so that the staff doesn't have to come to the meetings every night of the week.
For community members that are interested in both, so they're not having to go this Monday and this Thursday, so we can try and condense the time that people spend.
And to try to make it efficient. So I just wanted to point that out just in case there was any curiosity about that.
Right. On that note, how flexible would we be if, let's say we had applicants for sustainability, for instance, we had two great people, but Mondays don't work for them?
I think that would be up to the board, and administration will be as flexible as we need to in order to fit the needs of the board.
And is there any sort of a term limit, per se, for committee members, community members, so that they can all kind of get a chance to get hurt or discuss this? I didn't read anything about that, so.
Yeah, we talked about that.
Right. It's on the draft application. It had 1 year or 2 year commitment. It's also, people have a lot going on in their lives, and just as you are all volunteers, you know how much time it takes. So we also don't want to burn people out or not allow people to be part of things. So we're looking at either a 1 or a 2 year commitment.
I think we also talked about sort of requiring a reapplication every year.
Well,
right?
when the term is up.
Okay.
So we didn't want everyone turning over every year. So
that's
if we had someone had 1 year, someone had 2 years, so there was
so
a consistent knowledge base.
So we were going to stagger it a little bit so that there's not brand new membership. And just because your term comes up doesn't mean that you can't serve again. You can reapply, I think is what we decided.
Right.
Because, based on the pool of people that are willing to contribute.
So not strict term limits, mm-hmm. Raylan, but certainly with that reappointment function, if there were some other people that wanted to break in, they would be able.
So just as a point of information, I think on this sheet that is included in the packet, I was thinking that we had thought tentatively having sustainability at 5:30. Am I remembering that wrong? And governance at 7.
Well, there's. I know we went back and forth on that.
Yeah.
I think you're right. I think it was by the end of the afternoon, flipped it the other way.
I was thinking that we decided that sustainability would go first.
It's fine, either
right.
Whichever is, do we want to wait to, well, no, because we want to make sure the September meeting is correct, because we might not have community members in place by then, but.
Right.
Well, the only piece I'd, just as a point of reference, the governance committee does not include a regular community member. So probably if we're looking at someone that has a facility background as well as someone with financial background, 7 o'clock time might be easier to make than a 5:30
yeah.
time. It's the only thing in terms of logistically being able to.
That's a good point.
We might just have to wrap any, well, let's see. We might have to just wrap the confidential stuff for both committees at 10.
Can I just ask a point of clarification? I thought we were just presenting the idea now. Do you want a motion on the table before we discuss it, or are we discussing right now? I just want to
well, sort of questions and discussion, but we should have a motion. Yes. So there's a request to approve the all of the above committees and that structure for the 2015-16 school year.
I'll make that motion.
All right. Moved by Ms. Butters, seconded by Ms. Latosh. Now discussion on the motion.
So I know we had discussed before ways and opportunities to make our committees and such more reflective of diversity of our school district students, including where they come from. So I wondered if it might not be a good idea to, on the achievement committee, add another position that wouldn't be just the FMS at HS Drive, but maybe somebody from one of our other secondary programs.
Yeah, I mean, I think any secondary.
I'm just saying, just to have, I think it might be a good idea to have a third position there.
I think that's good.
From TCEC or from UHS or?
It's something that we have struggled with. We don't always have rental participation, you know, from some of the other communities that we serve. And I think if we had a specific position to fill, we could actively recruit, you know, with the help of the building administrators. I don't know, I think it'd be really good.
Okay. Any other thoughts on that? Would there be any objection to amending the structure then?
No.
Hearing none, is that not? Amend that?
Yep.
It is so amended at the motion. All right, any other discussion?
Just one quick clarification on the dates. I seem to remember there, I know that this isn't necessarily pertinent because whichever community members we get, we're thinking probably won't be able to join us for the September meeting, right? Because we're looking at a September 20th. But I think that there was a communication from you to us recently saying, talking about an August 31st governance meeting, or was that, I don't agree. Is that not on the calendar?
So we might have that governance committee also.
Oh, really?
We can move that to the 31st and the 14th. That'd be either one since we didn't want to do it on Labor Day.
Right.
So it's not both. It's not both.
Right. It can be
the 31st and the 14th. Oh.
No, it'd be one or the other. So that way it's done before the board meeting. So that
I'm fine with the 14th.
Could anybody not make the 31st? Well, we can, the meeting dates are not part of the motion, so we can figure that out.
Sorry, I thought it was.
I think you pulled that for.
That's right, the meeting's got.
Right, yeah, that was the whole meeting.
So not including the dates or times?
No, just the structure.
The structure, yeah.
Okay, so this chart is still technically tentative.
Yes.
Correct, until we get back to members.
And the other thing in terms of the appointment process, the committees would need to meet to make their recommendations on appointments, and then the president and board would make the appointments at a meeting that probably if it's open through September 20th.
At the October meeting, then?
At the October meeting, yes. Although there's nothing in the bylaws that specifically gives the way of appointment meeting. We can report out at the next meeting applicant, you know, at the number of applicants, so that we still need to show somebody to make appointments then. And for instance, there's no need to wait until next meeting.
So also one request I would have just in terms of once this is approved tonight, then what we're going to be doing is actively recruiting people to apply for these positions. So I guess I would be interested in if there's some quick and easy way to put this verbiage on the website.
It's on the application.
Okay, and then so that can be something that we link to, like we want to send an email to someone who we think would be interested, and then we can send that with the information and with the description.
Right, the link on the web.
So if that's easily accessible on the website, that would be great. And also, I think that it would be good if we could make it clear somewhere on the Board of Ed page what committees we're all on, I think it'd be good if we had that.
Yeah.
Of all of us.
Man's on camp duty.
Right, and Man's on interlocking committee this week.
The best.
And I just want to point out that I think it's great that we're opening up these meetings to the community, because I think it's important for community members to see that extensive conversation and discussion occur at these subcommittees, and that you, you know, you can be a part of that. But I don't want people to think that you come to the board meetings without having discussed things in a great detail prior to the board meetings. So I'm glad that you'll be involved.
And I want to underscore that really the only reason to close a meeting, because I saw a little trepidation out there. You know, this is something I talked with school board members across the state. There are always going to be some things, especially when coming to human resources and things like that, that it's good to have the doors closed just for, you know, privacy and things like that. So it's usually out of a place of respect and not anything else.
Right. The alternative is really to not have it discussed at all. Certainly decision making is
and there. Sometimes it may not be a means for something else that's really sort of giving us the guidance to keep it moving well.
Right. All right, any other discussion on the motion? Then roll call, please.
Patash?
Yes.
Eastman?
Yes.
Toomey?
Yes.
Butters?
Yes.
Deacon Krause?
Yes.
President O'Donnell?
Yes. Motion passes unanimously. The committee structure is approved. The next item is our annual financial resolutions, which are related to board bylaw on the financial organization meeting. So,
second, pull that up.
Yes.
So these are generally the things that we have to approve every year. So it's up to the board if you can approve them all together or if you want to approve them separately. I'd recommend approving all together unless there's a certain area that you'd like to have further discussion. But it's the approval to designate the depositories, which are generally the banks that we use. Those are all staying the same. Designation of persons to sign checks, contracts, agreements, purchase orders. Again, that stays the same. Established fee for board meeting notices, which we do not have a fee, same as last year. Appointment of school elections liaison, again, same as last year. Medical facility for employment physical and drug testing, same as last year. One change, we did take Middle Cities off of our board memberships. I think that was about a $7,000 savings. We found that that really wasn't netting us really any benefit, as opposed to MASB and Metro Bureau. So even both of those are less than the amount that was expended for Middle City, so we'll reduce that line item. And the appointment of district legal counsel, which again is the same as last year. And just to draw attention to the board, the Durant matters and the Adair matters are something that are ongoing every year for every district that we have to do. Those are generally the approvals. The only change was the deletion of Middle Cities and that budget.
Right, and just as a technical matter, probably means the member as our is one of the signers. Fortunately, she wasn't here last summer.
Yes, that's true. The addition of Nancy's name.
All right, I will entertain a motion to approve that batch of requests.
Can we pull up the new council?
Yes.
Yes. Yep.
So now I will entertain a motion to approve all of the requests except for the approval of legal counsel. Moved by Mr. Deacon Krause and seconded by Ms. Leakes May. Any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Leakes May?
Yes.
Excuse me, Toomey?
Yes.
Butters?
Yes.
Deacon Krause?
Yes.
Latash?
Yes.
And President O'Donnell?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right, and now a motion to appoint district legal counsel as presented by Mr. Pruitt. And so I'll entertain that motion. You are going to recuse.
I'm going to recuse myself. And I don't have any conflict of interest, but.
Right. That is a good point. Moved by Ms. Butters, seconded by Ms. Toomey. Any discussion on the motion? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Toomey?
Yes.
Butters?
Yes.
Deacon Kraus?
Yes.
Ratash?
Stay.
Leaksmay?
Yes.
And President O'Donnell?
Yes. And that motion passes one extension unanimously. Next up is the informational items, and we'll start with the superintendent's report.
Yes, we have our administrators from our new TCEC program. We're going to talk about our new alternative education program. And since we've talked a lot about the DLC last year, been making some very good positive changes for next year, and wanted to inform the board. So I'll give the floor. TCEC program, where she built a great program for the last 8 years. This is part of the intergovernmental agreement with Berkeley to kind of restart our program using the best pieces of Mindy's former program. So I know it's bittersweet for her to be with us and have the ability to remake our program, and yet on the other hand, having the loss of the program from there. So we're very happy to have her and her expertise along with Sandy Grosso. So this is kind of part of what the board approved with that intergovernmental agreement.
Thank you. And it's bittersweet, but it's mostly sweet. So we're good. So restorative practices will be a change. I don't know how familiar people are with that. We have to really bring our staff on board. I can tell you from personal experience, it changed our school probably about 6 years ago when we trained a pretty good critical mass of the staff in what it meant to become a community and understand that when there's a problem, that it's kind of everybody's problem, and that you can hold people accountable and you can do it in a way that respects
their dignity and humanity. And that was, and also the restorative piece is that, that there's some healing and there's some hope to get to a better place at the end of the conflict. So we're gonna try that. I've seen it work once, I think it can work again. And a couple more things that you might want to add?
Yes, we had taken the adult program and offered a lot of opportunities for interaction between the students, staff, and how the program ran. So we intend to do that same, extend that kind of commitment from us as a group and as a whole, which will also thrive with the restorative practices. We offered an opportunity for student government and we had an opportunity to see a small community grow. At graduation, people would always say, this is like meeting my family. Well, that was their sense of being part of their program. So we will just break it out and expand it into this new program. It could be very exciting. The community, particularly the school, the Grant community, is a very strong and close community. I have been very welcoming. We've been out speaking with the people that are in the library, the people who are using the library, people in the hallways. It's very welcoming. They're very excited to have us in the building. So I'm looking forward to bringing the whole community into that building.
So you want to talk about structure part?
No.
Okay. Well, the other side of the sheet.
And there you go.
We've been living it. So, mentoring will be a key piece of this. You know, there's mentoring that's part of the pupil accounting language, but this is really going to be mentoring whereby teachers have groups of students that they're going to follow and hopefully stay with for the length of the time that the student is with us. So there'll be the practical pieces of the mentoring that the pupil accounting folks call for, but then there'll be the human piece too, and they really will be another set of go-to people that help sort of form the safety net around every kid, because they need more than one of us to be caring and involved in what's going on with them.
We thought that we could implement this, because we have so many different age groups, all with the same direction of wanting to have high school diploma or prepare for GED. And our lowest functioning adults, they would be in the ABE program. And this year, for the first time, one of our ESL programs will be in the building. Our morning program, we lost access to JCC in Oak Park because it's closing. So we are now having a set of our English second language learners come into the building, which I think will be a very interesting and wonderful dynamic, because that stretches even more of the cultural awareness in our program. We have attempted to really open up options for our students in their scheduling, in the tracking. We're all offering an opportunity to be completely and wholly online. We are also operating where you could be half online and half in the building, all in the building, or combination thereof. So we're trying to make it as user-friendly and appropriate for the learners that we have. Because even though you may not be an adult, you may have a job, you may have children, and it will give us that opportunity to offer people, when they need something, what we have to do with them.
So yeah, the scheduling is probably a little different than you might have last heard. We're gonna operate Monday through Friday. We're not gonna split the group into two different schedules. And that should be fine. Because of how flexible the scheduling is, because we have some blocks of time that are computer-based and some blocks that are teacher-led classes. And we know that kids really enjoy having a variety of different options. So so Monday through Thursday is gonna be, they'll be the primary days, but Fridays are available for students that want to come and just exclusively do work in the lab or get extra help. And Fridays will be important days. I can tell you from experience, we did Fridays half days. And to say we had half the kids would be generous. We usually had maybe a quarter of the kids on Friday. So I think this is a good model, and I think it'll make a lot of sense. And we can insist that some kids come in on Fridays if they haven't been there much during the week and get them caught up. And so this solves some other problems as well.
We had a model like this in the adult program, and we called it Amnesty Days, and we held them on Fridays. It was an opportunity, very much the same opportunity. And it was a frightening experience to think, to give up a day. And this last winter count, we made our county an amnesty day, I figured. If we fail, we fail. And it was about three times the amount of people came on county than normally we come in winter, because they needed to discuss things with their staff, or their students, their not their students, with their teachers. So it was this little mimic that same kind of opportunity.
The restorative justice frame is what, when people ask me about discipline, that's what I start talking about. So, again, you can see that on here, but mostly we solve problems by talking. What a concept. I'm big on nonviolence in all aspects of my life. And so we have to make that language part of everybody's language.
Which will be part of the beginning of our formula of receive culture. And the last thing that's on here, age and time of enrollment. Unfortunately, the restrictions within public education, the youngest students, 14 and 15 year old, will not be allowed to be in the same program and building along with anyone over the age of 20. And that's where the adult, well, it used to be where the adult started, but it's a law. So our 14 and 15 year old, our youngest learners, will be strictly online learners. Our goal is, if possible, we are trying to promote the use of being the schools of choice for the UHS or FHS, depending on your particular request and interest. But they will be mentored very much the same as everyone else, and they will have access to that building on Fridays so that they can meet with their teachers or whomever it is they need to meet with. So, any questions?
You mentioned that you've been able to reach out a little bit to the people who use the library over at the Grant Building. Are there other plans you have to connect with the surrounding neighborhood in terms of sort of creating some relationship between the school and the neighbors?
I would like to. We had a wonderful process. It came from a not such good reason when we first opened up the TAC building. We implemented something called Coffee and Conversation, and we would blanket the neighborhood and invite people into the building for meetings. At the very beginning, the meetings contained a lot of pitchforks and all sorts of bad things. But as we started to get that connection with the people that were in the community, it turned out to be a very positive experience. And when we ran, I don't even recall, it was open nights where families and members of the community came in and participated with ideas and games and things such as that. I would like to re-implement that same process in that community, because I think it's important for us all to understand. One particular, one goal that we have is that we need to make partnerships with training and non-post-secondary opportunities for learners. And the members of the community there had asked if we would, in fact, have those opportunities of building. So that's one of our goals, is to make that possible.
That's great.
Any more questions? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It sounds like a great structure and great start.
Come visit.
What's that?
Visit.
Visit
us.
Oh, all right.
That would be great.
We could use an extra answer. I have an update on summer bond work. Some we've seen if you parked out front. So there are a few remaining items from the original bond application that we're finishing up. And then the board will have to make some decisions regarding the allocation of the remaining bond funds, which that's the first positive piece, is that we will have some level of remaining bond funds when all the projects are done. So it means that we've been fiscally responsible in administering the bond. As if you have read over the years, there's some districts that have run out of bond funds before their projects are done. So a couple things are going on. The Roosevelt flooring was finished this week, and I haven't had the opportunity to go over and see the final product or actually verify that it's all done.
Jump on it.
Yes, sir. I believe that the carpet is down. I'm pretty sure the wood trim and all the finishing work is not done. As you know, this is the third attempt at the Roosevelt flooring. So for any of you that have seen, and this might be the only board meeting in the state where you can do this, if you've ever seen Monty Python and the Holy Grail, you know, the three times the castle comes down, this is sort of, yes, thank you. And this is hopefully our third time. We had a multiple flooring consultants come out, as well as a couple architects, so we could get some third-party evaluations. They took these, took all the subfloor out, so we were down to the original 1920s wood. In looking at it, the flooring that originally was approved there by the board is a rubber flooring that normally goes on concrete, because it is not meant to flex. When it flexes, we get the issues that we had where corners pop up and it looks sort of like a wave. It's a 1920s building with a wood subfloor. So it was impossible for anyone to give us a warranty on the install of the third time of the rubber flooring, which I was not going to accept. So in working with the consultants, talking it through, really the only material that flexes is carpet. That is the only thing that works on wood flooring. Everything else will pop up. And carpet is what we can get a warranty on. All this was done as warranty work. There's not one dime to the district expended for any of this. The final evaluation was that if we were to continue with rubber floor, A, we'd get no warranty from the company, so if it came up again, it would be on our dime to handle. And no one could give us any warranty that the application would work. So at that point, it was looking at what sort of carpet will be the best application, what will hold up the best. What's going in is carpet that will minimally 10 to 15 years life expectancy, which is good life expectancy for a floor. It is in a square, so it can be replaced if certain areas get more wear and tear than another, but it is meant for school applications and used in many other schools. That was the final determination on what was going to happen with Roosevelt flooring. Without that, we would not have a floor to start the year. Or we'd have a floor that, in December, I'd be coming back to him saying, I need to use bond funds to put the carpet down because the top of the rubber tile's coming out. So that's where that sits. So that one should be ready in time for the start of school year. The concrete asphalt work, which was part of the bond, is done. Obviously, there's always more concrete, there's always more asphalt for us to finish, to repair. There's only a certain amount of money in the bond funds, so we pick the most critical pieces in working with our transportation department, working with Plant Grant, working with AUK, in evaluating what were the worst areas. If we find that we have money left over after the end of the bond, we can decide if some of the second-tier areas might need to be worked on. We had very, very little under a couple thousand dollars of general carpentry work. That was mostly at Harding. Take the walls down in the gym so that could become a gym for the early childhood center, and taking some walls down in the old tech room so that could become a classroom. So that was done, and there's a little bit of work at Roosevelt in a room that a wall had to be taken down to prepare it for a kindergarten classroom. Once again, all minor work, but all done. And if you've seen as you've walked in the doors, our door access system is installed. So we'll be getting training on that, as well as getting all the key cards out for everyone to have access to the doors. And all the buzzer systems are in place and ready to be operational. So that's all set. And that came in well under budget from what was originally in the bond. The next group of projects. We have two projects that would be winter projects because we're going to get better pricing in the winter that were part of the original bond. One was the high school railings in this building to make sure everything is brought up to code. We are in the process of getting the drawings. The estimate from the architect is that it'll come in around $100,000 or less. It was allocated $500,000. So obviously that will come in significantly under budget, which will give us a little bit of extra money to look at other buildings. We decided not to make them out of gold nor platinum. So originally they were going to take out all the railings. There's a way that you can fabricate on top of the railings. It's far less expensive and just as sturdy, and we don't have that open holes on the trestle floor. One piece of the security, part of security in the bond was to make sure that all buildings could be locked down. One of our issues in this building is the wall by the elephant stairs. If you just see the bottom, the cinder block is crumbling. It's my understanding that that was originally was student built. As they used to have the geodome in here and a couple other things, that there started to be some issues of people coming through at night. So that was originally student built, so very well maintained for that period of time. But also the gates, you cannot lock down due to fire code, because those gates have to be open during the day. So anyone that would be a possible intruder, and so hopefully if there, you know, no one hears this on the tape, you can just easily get right into the courtyard, which is an issue. So by taking all that down, putting up new material, and putting in fire doors, that allows us to lock down the whole facility all day long. There will be an Eagle as well as an FHS up on the wall as you walk up to it, and we're leaving some panels for installation of some local, hopefully metal artwork, working with a couple artists to see if we can get something there. Or if we can find ways for students to do it, so we put some more work on the students permanently. So that's in process. Those are the last projects really within the bond. We do have a couple remaining issues that are trying to resolve. Our air conditioning unit in Tech East, which is our main server room, has been having some ongoing issues. So we are working with AUK and with Plant Moran and Oakland Schools regarding what to do with that, so we can make sure that we keep the integrity of our servers. There are some issues we're evaluating.
Where? Which building?
Here at the high school, Tech East. All the servers from Harding, originally we had two server rooms. For the size school district and space we have, we don't have the need for two server rooms. It's better for cost to have one room as opposed to super cooling two rooms. So everything's being moved down there because there is a ton of space. And they installed a new AC unit, and we're finding this summer there are some issues that were unknown or might have not been thought of when designed, so we're evaluating what to do.
If there are additional expenditure of funds that need to be done for redesign or new equipment installation, that would be done out of bond funds then.
Yes, anything done would have to be done out of bond funds. No general fund if we need to do anything.
And to be clear, these servers, while being housed in one location, are still being backed up according to protocols.
Yes. Yep.
So even issue with that before.
Even if they were to go down, they're backed up in multiple spaces. The issue is more of the actual equipment and replacing of equipment in that expenditure.
Can I just add, this is something that probably should have been known ahead of time, that we don't need two server rooms for a district this size. I assume that's something that, I know it's difficult to second guess the past, although it's been pretty easy to do of late, but this does seem like something that should have been brought to the board's attention.
For just providing servers and technology for the school district, correct?
It might have been a tougher call when we were going our own way in the school district that I didn't participate with Oakland Schools. Then I can see, you know, then I think it's a closer call on having a redundant server room. But
my understanding is that there was a plan to expand service outside the school district that ever came to fruition. So that's something I'll need to continue to update on. Hopefully it won't be extra expenditures, but if so, we are working to try and see which parties would have that expense. One of the last remaining issues is also with HVAC. It's the control system that was approved in what's called Bulletin 13. It was an extra bulletin. It was an add-on approved, I believe, about a year and a half to 2 years ago. And that's supposed to put everything online, but not everything in the district goes online. So for example, these classrooms on this side of the building may be on the online system, but then the third floor on that part of the building is not online. So not everything is online. So for example, tonight, this room is being controlled by the computer system, and we can send an email to facilities to say, please keep the air on until 9 o'clock because the board meeting is here. Other rooms, that is impossible. It is done by thermostat or by sometimes act of God. So not all rooms are contained within the system. So we are still working on making sure that all the rooms that are supposed to be in the system are in the system, they can be maintained properly and everything works. One thing the board will have to consider as we look at either remaining bond funds, funds from the sale of buildings or possible sinking funds down the road, is there is a significant energy savings if everything in the district is attached, because then per se, when a building's not being operated on the weekend, you can raise the set points, just like you do at home. If you're not there during the workday, you set your set point higher so you're not wasting energy. If we can't do that, then obviously rooms run, you know, at whatever temp they are. So, and we do have a grant-funded evaluation from the state giving us some guidelines in terms of what buildings are the most efficient and the least efficient and what things that we should do. So that's something that will, I mean, that will continue to be something we evaluate. So any questions regarding remaining bond items or summer bond update?
Specifically, really about everything, but specifically about the door access system. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if there are plans to have communication with the school community about that. It's going to, you know, parents will be seeing a change in how they enter buildings.
Yep.
Probably before school starts would be nice if it's going to be up and running before school.
Not a problem. It would be within the beginning of the year information from the buildings, but we can also include it within the district level. Okay. Any other questions? A short update regarding restructuring. Just as you can see, hence being in this building, for our board meeting, there's been a lot of moves this summer. We had the early childhood move to the Harding building, the Harding building move up to the third floor, and then adult alternative ed move to the Grant building. So there's been a lot of movement. That also means that there's also a lot of excess furniture that we'll be looking to do and auction with. There are companies that do this for school districts, the same as we have done with our buses in the past, which will then be some extra money that can go into general fund to help offset some other things. I don't perceive it'll be a lot, but it'll be something. And furniture that, you know, we're not using, everyone in the district has been through what they need. So both ourselves and the Career Center have done this, as well as we have some old technology that we can auction off in order to get some more funds into general fund. So we will be having going out soon, our next restructuring committee day, that will be going out to everyone that's been involved in the committees, so that we can start that process up and meeting again. We've been working with administrators on timelines for events and getting things moving in each committee. So that will be coming up shortly. In September, we should be presenting the board with some timelines on some things that are going on with the restructuring. But the first wave this summer is pretty much done and moving forward.
Thank you, Mr. Pruitt. Next up is the finance report. Nancy Hoover. Good evening.
Hello. You're currently in the room covering your audit. The auditors came in last Tuesday, and they should be completing their work at the end of this week, maybe running into a day or two next week. We originally had hoped to be able to bring the audit report to the board in September, but I learned today, because of GASB 68, we're required to put a portion of the pension liability onto our books. we can, the auditors will not be able to release an opinion to us until the MIBSER's audit is complete, and until those numbers are off it. And they're looking at getting those numbers at the end of September. So while our audit will be complete, and we'll probably have very final numbers, except for this footnote disclosure around the entries that we need to make prior to that liability. So we'll keep you abreast of how that's going. But we are very optimistic on how that's going. We are also very close to finishing our additional cuts to the budget. That was in line with the board's request of the administration. And we're being very conservative in our cuts to make sure that they are all achievable. I've also included a preliminary schedule comparing percentage of the budgets by function, comparing that to where we were at the end of 2014-15 with the same percentages. And you'll see as we're making these cuts, we're really working very hard to keep those cuts out of the classroom. At the end of 14-15, our final budget, our budget was about a little over 51% instruction. Where we're at now is about 56%, so we're really looking to increase that.
So the projections as of right now, obviously those changes we get to First Amendment, is we're increasing overall instructional spending out of the entire budget by 5%.
Right. And the overall reduction is in the support service area.
Okay. So one of the things the board had asked originally was that, because in summary and surveys in the county, we have been one on the lower end of instructional spending, on the upper end of non-instructional spending, was for the administration to start to bring that up or to change it. So you know, while these numbers are still fluid, it's looking like, you know, based upon what we have right now and on the budget the board passed and us looking to achieve that, where we are increasing our instructional spending and getting ourselves higher in percentage within the county. You know, up 5%, and working to decrease the non-instructional spending so that we're more in line with where the county is. Our eventual goal is to be at, you know, at or surpass county average within instructional spending. So we're doing better on that. We're getting closer to that, but there's still very fluid numbers that we're looking at.
That 5 percentage point shift seems to be a very significant shift in 1 year. You know, so I think that is probably the most progress that one could make in a single budget cycle.
That we were very happy that in doing the numbers that we were able to at least get to there. Our goal is to continue to do that so that a larger percent of our budget each year goes towards instruction. Since then, we should hopefully be able to get to county average so that we're on par.
And I just wanted to highlight and remind that while we as board members are not financial experts, we certainly don't micromanage. One of our functions is to oversee that audit process and to do adjustments in this. So this year did represent a few changes to the way we did our audit and just to try and have some better controls and security for the district board. So, you know, that's...
We'll be working on much more solid numbers and percentages at the next sustainability committee meeting, because these are still soft numbers that we're working on.
This was a slightly different and more thorough audit than our district was in the past, and we could have a better prognosis of what's going on. So I'm excited about that.
Yeah, the change in auditing firms was probably the most critical part of that.
I don't know if enjoy is the right
thing. You don't have to really enjoy it, but we get through it. And actually, it was really good. We changed all this because they held a seminar today, helping us with the GASB 68 entry. Really excited to hear about it. But they are the only firm that is doing that.
Just, it's not the great Gatsby.
So regarding the budget, at the Sustainability Committee meeting, will there be, will we have more drill-down numbers
yes.
that we can get to kind of see how that 5% shift has happened? And then will there be, what are we looking at in terms of an amendment? Is it for the next meeting or for October?
Well, probably not till we get solid count numbers, which due to the online piece, won't be to the end of the count window. So we'll start preparing based upon the evidence we have at the next sustainability. We should, in September, have some indication of where the fund equity would be, because we should have relatively solid numbers from the audit at that point, although not being able to approve them until October. And we should have, at least within our K-12, by that first week of count, we should have solid numbers there. The issue has always been the alternative ed program with the different way they do count. We should have a good idea of where we're headed and what things we need to do.
No pressure.
It's not, it's okay.
Well, it's the reality of the situation.
Lots of pressure.
So that'll be in sustainability now that we're starting to develop more solid numbers. We can look at where the budget is, where the percentages are, and then also once we get more solid enrollment, of course, enrollment and the revenue doesn't really match the revenue that we had in the original budget. Best case scenario, the revenue is more, and that provides us, provides more opportunity.
And the district and the union will continue to have their scheduled meetings throughout the next few months to be updated on
the situation. We want to work very closely with the union all the different unions all through this process, so that all the information as we gather and develop it, because it does change on a daily basis, but so that we can keep people up to date on a regular basis.
Next up is the enrollment report with Mr. Real Good.
How's everybody doing? That good?
Great.
Yes.
All right. So now we get to the fun stuff. We're just going to talk about audit, then we're going to talk about enrollment, and then it's just keep on coming, right? All right, so I apologize to people in the audience for not having copies. There should be a couple extra ones floating around, but I wasn't anticipating this big of a crowd, so I apologize. Just to go over quickly what we've been up to this summer in the enrollment office, the different ways we've been going about advertising Ferndale schools. To start off, this year was the first year we've started to do digital ads. And so what I mean by that is we've actually started to do cell phone targeting. This is kind of a test thing we've done this year, specifically with the TCEC and UHS. The company we're working with is able to put up markers that if you drive through with your cell phone or you go to certain apps or certain websites within a certain geographic area, then you'll get seeded with one of our ads. And so we're able to do 2 million impressions. 1 million on mobile phones and 1 million on websites. And the boundaries we drew were very specific to where we traditionally get our UHS and DLC and TCEC students from. So roughly 8 mile to 6 mile, 75 to Telegraph. So all 2 million impressions were focused in that area. What's also great about doing digital advertising is you get detailed reports and you can tell exactly what type of return on investment you get. Where if you do a mailer or you put up a billboard, you're just kind of throwing information out there and you don't know what your actual return is going to be. With a digital ad, you get a report that says this many people went out, this many people clicked on it, this many people went through. And then we can also track that on our website and really to see the people who came in from there and then how long they spent on the site, did they go to the enrollment page. And so we're actually really able to track very specifically the return on the investment, which is something we haven't been able to do in the past. So we're really excited to see how that works. It ended 2 days ago, so I should get in the full report here soon so we know how successful it actually was. The other thing we did in the more traditional route, we had 3 billboards up One for UHS, one for TCEC, and one for our early childhood center. UHS and TCEC ones were both on 8 Mile. They were both up for 2 months. The early childhood center one was also on 8 Mile in Jalnara in the Hazel Park area. That's been up for, it'll be up for about a month total, come down on September 1st. We also sent out 52,000 mailers, again, to that 8 Mile, 6 Mile, 75 to Telegraph area. If you have the presentation, you can see it's highlighted in red. The goal with that area was to hit people in multiple ways and multiple mediums. So you have the digital ads, you have the billboard, and you have the mail to each individual home. So the idea is you're going to see it in multiple different ways. You're not really sure which one you see or which one causes you to call, but it's layered in your head and it reinforces that message. We also, these are still ongoing, we made a whole bunch of phone calls. Thank you to Mindy and Sandra and their team. We called and also the ACMs at the end of last year, called 1,700 dropped DLC students in the past 3 years. That's not a misprint. It was 1,700 dropped DLC students over the past 3 years. Yeah, we're still eligible to come back, to encourage them to come back. We made a list from that of people who were interested and then called them again. We also called all of the Berkeley TCEC students last year that didn't graduate, as well as their drops from the past 3 years as well. We had the 10th anniversary party for UHS, which was a big success. We had more than 100 people who attended it, both alumni and new students, so that was a really fantastic event. We've also been all over the place this summer. We went to the Wild Summer Night Zoo Concert Series. We were there 4 times. We went to different events at the Ferndale Library. We were at 7 for those. We were also at Belle Isle Kids Day, Oak Grove School Expo, Oak Park Summer Fest for 2 days, African World Fest at the Charles Wright Museum this past weekend, First Baptist Church School Expo, the Family Victory Fellowship Church School Expo, as well as the Winans Academy and Highland Park High School. They both closed down this year, so we had presence in those neighborhoods as well to try to capture some of those students who didn't have a place to go. We also, again, did social media advertising, primarily with Facebook, just some advertising or some examples here on this page. We did it for all of our programs, so there was an ad for just about every single program that we had. We also redid the enrollment websites for UHS and TCEC so that they matched our current branding. That way, if you see the picture on the advertisement, it's the same picture you see on the website. So when you click through, you know you're at the right place. As part of the School Expo package, we did through WDIV. If you remember, we went to the School Expo at Oakland Mall, I think it was in April. The second part of that package was they also produced a television commercial for us, as well as gave us 100,000 ads on their site. So the site ads go up this week. The commercial will air 20 times, starting on last Friday through September 6th. So right up to the start of school. And that's airing. We'll also have it up on our website for folks that can see it. Yes, they can see it as well.
And we have a couple for Ferndale parents that are
in the ad, correct? Yeah, they're Colton Boss and your husband is Paul Boss. Yeah. Yeah, they were very generous with their time to allow us to interview them, and it turned out really nice. Dean and her team have been running around like crazy people all summer, but they somehow found time to run the early childhood playdates, which have been great. They've been very well attended. It's been a great way to reach out to the community and get new families in who weren't previously considering Ferndale schools to meet some of our existing families. We also sent out 700 letters to some of the adult and adult alternative ed students who had dropped over the past year, letting them know about the TCEC change. We've had the marquee at Woodward 9 Mile on and off all summer. I'm sure as you came in today, you saw our 2 new early college and Cambridge banners on the front of the school. We did a Montessori ad in last month's Metro Parent, and we had an early childhood center ad in this week's Back to School Ferndale Friends. And then also on the last page there, you'll see the new Eagle Pride signs, which thank you, Jim Schaefer, again, for donating those. They're currently on order, and they should be ready to be handed out the first day of school. So, talking about some more numbers now for the summer. One thing I will note is that today is August 17th, so we are about a month until school starts, about 2 months till count, and about 3 months from TCEC count ending. So all the numbers we're going to talk right now are very primary. I would say that the term of the day is cautiously optimistic. Things are looking good, but again, we're a long way from the finish line.
I just want to qualify something there. On average, our district over the last number of years has had about 100 drops during this time frame. That's just the average. It's not, that's been for a long period of time. That's been about the average.
Over the course of all grades.
Over the course of all grades. It's not abnormal for a district to have drops during this time period. You hope you always offset with the additions.
It's not net drops, it's drops that are compensated for sometimes.
Right, hopefully, you know, people move out, people move in. But, so, we haven't received many of the drops yet. This is not really, you know, probably in the next couple of weeks, especially the first week of school, that's when it's hard, when all of a sudden the kids aren't there, or you get the information then, and you've already made all your staffing decisions. So, keep in consideration as we look at the numbers, that does not include the historic drops, because there was really no data for Bill to look at in terms of how many drops we get the first week in August on average, how many we get the second week on average. They're starting to keep track of that now so we can get a better historical idea. And obviously as the economy changes and you know, that will have some influence on us too. So that's why we say take this with a grain of salt, because it might include the kids that we've recruited, but it does not disclude the kids that have moved to other places.
And one thing I just want to add to that too, one of the challenging things we've gone through these last couple of weeks is staffing. And I know poor Tom's been pulling his hair out because we just don't know how many kids we're going to have right now. And so when you think you might have to add a teacher in a grade, you know, when do you go and worry about hiring that teacher? Obviously you want to do it the sooner the better, but we don't know because we just don't have concrete numbers. So one of the things, as Blake said, we're really starting to track now is the dates of things. So when do our students primarily enroll? When do our students primarily drop? What's our conversion rate from a new resident or school's choice application that we get that actually makes it to count? So that now next year at this time we'll be able to say, well, last year, you know, 90% of our drops are in by August 25th. So by August 25th, we'll know a good, you know, good number of where we're at. Where if we get 200 schools of choice applications, we can say, well, we convert 75% of the applications we receive to students that are counted. So we can kind of get a feeling for how many are going to show up. So a lot of that stuff is stuff that was kind of tracked in the past, or stuff that can pull up in MyStar, but not as specifically as we'd like. So it is stuff that we're starting to build processes to be able to track now.
I always want to be clear, this is not unique to Ferndale, this is every school district. Mm-hmm. And as I talk to superintendents, as you know, other people in other districts, everyone experiences this time frame. When you pull the trigger on certain class numbers, you're talking to another local district, you know, they had an issue last year where they brought someone on and all of a sudden 25 kids didn't show that they thought were going to show. So this is just the yin and yang of relying on people FTE for your budget.
So to start off, we're just going to kind of work our way sequentially from the youngest to the oldest. So our early childhood classroom is doing fantastic. The Little Eagles, we have two full classrooms as well as seven on the waiting list. I will say that these numbers are all as of last Thursday, so more may have added since then. And remember last year at this time, we were fighting to get half of a class. So within a year's time to be at two full classes as well as a waiting list for a third is really significant growth. For our GSRP class, we have 11 of our 32 slots filled. For Head Start, we have 38 of our 67 slots filled. We also have an additional 32 applications that are being interviewed right now. So we should have most of our slots filled relatively soon. So as far as historical precedent goes, Little Eagles is dramatically ahead of where it was last year. GSRP and Head Start are about on par with they were last year, maybe a little bit further ahead. As far as our First Fives program, we right now have 16 enrolled for that. We typically have about 15 or 16, so that's right on par. So if we add any more, it'll go a little bit higher than we traditionally have. For the Montessori classroom, currently right now we have 20 enrolled. Five have come in since we expanded to the Tri-County window. That expires, I believe, at the end of this month. So hopefully we'll add some more and bump the Montessori class up. But we have seen quite a bit of action with that and interest in it for the last couple of weeks, which has been encouraging. As far as the Cambridge program, just looking at total numbers for 7th and 8th grade, we have 154 in the ELA science class and 87 in the math class. So those are both doing very well attended. I've heard multiple parents remark that that's the reason that they're staying for Ferndale Schools is for the Cambridge program. So that to me is a home run so far. As far as the early college program, just a great anecdote here. Currently we have 28 at Ferndale High School and 31 at UHS, so right around 60. Carl was at a meeting last week where they had a student statewide meeting for all of the early colleges, for statewide, they all come together and meet and go through their introductory classes, and they were going around the room to all these different school districts, and some of them were run by counties, not just individual districts, and how many do you have? Well, we have 8. How many do you have? We have 6. How many do you have? We have 12. How many do you have? We have 60. So we are by far the largest early college program, I believe, in the state. I mean, by multiple times over. So that's really...
I'm going to qualify that for a second. So, because there's early college school, like Oakland Early College, with its own separate entity. The kids leave their high school and go to a separate building. There's a couple of those. Mott Early College being the biggest one that has a couple hundred, Oakland Early College, a couple hundred. What we're doing is programmatic, where it's within the school. And when we met with Baker, because they run about 10 of these, and they said that we have had the best startup, both in numbers and preparation. Said that we're about a year or two ahead of what they normally see in the prep work. But that's been very exciting to see the interest level, of Baker and what they want to be part of. And early college is growing. The county tried to start a programmatic one through the county, and countywide they weren't part of it's the price structure. But we will surpass that county number, and that. From a financial standpoint, you take 60 students in 2 years and they're doing a 13th year, where we're able to get that FTE, our light sensors work. Good. No, they don't.
Somebody just moved.
So when you look at, in terms of sustainability of the district, financially, not academically for a second, those 60 students do a 13th year with their full FTE, that's significant to the district. While students can get an associate's degree, our teachers can become adjunct professors for Baker if they so want. So it's a win from a financial standpoint, it's a win from an academic standpoint. Sorry.
No. Good. And one of the other things we've seen so far, which has been fantastic, is for those of you who don't know, the early college program starts in 11th grade, and so we've seen a significant number of 9th and 10th graders, both at UHS and FHS, that have enrolled specifically for the early college program. So this year at FHS we have 12 9th graders and 5 10th graders. At UHS we have 18 9th graders and 11 10th graders. So I'd say significant numbers that are, again, not just here for the 11th and 12th and 13th year, but are here for 9th and 10th. We also have a couple of 8th graders too, but just a small handful of those as well. If you look at our schools of choice and new resident numbers, we've seen a total of 305 applications for schools of choice and new residents. We have not tracked new residents in the past, so we don't know if this is a high number for new residents or not. So currently we have 152 schools of choice applications and 153 new residents. Just to give you a frame of reference, last year we received approximately 90 schools of choice applications. So we're already about 60 ahead of where we were last year. The new resident population is largely kindergarten families, so out of the 153, about 120 of them are kindergartners. So if you look at our Ferndale Schools K-12 enrollments, that would be minus TCEC and UHS. We're about 2,122. That is not including the 84 applications that are still being processed. I think we got another 5 more today. So that's good. Those are solid numbers as of now. If you look at UHS, we have roughly 315 students returning. Again, it doesn't count drops. So far, we have 106 approved applications. We received 174. The historical precedent, we're about 20 approved applications ahead of where we are this time of the year in the past. Traditionally, UHS has a big influx of kids the first week of school. They normally get 40 to 50 in the first week of school, so if that continues on top of these current numbers, UHS will see a pretty good growth. Looking at the TCEC, this is a trickier one to kind of forecast, just to, again, to give you a little more historical precedent. In the past, the way it was done with our alternative education was, at the end of each school year, any student who didn't graduate was automatically rolled over to the program for the next year. This led to us having some artificially high expectations for the program. because not all the students obviously come back. So what we did this year was we just dropped all the students and we let them know that they needed to fill out an intent to return form and then re-enroll. That way we knew for sure that the kids coming back were invested in the program. So currently we have 90 high school age students and 40 adult students. That isn't cause for alarm yet, it being that low. Traditionally, as Mindy and Sandra will tell you, these students show up the first 2 weeks of September. So we will get a substantial number of people who show up September 15th, the week after school starts. Something to keep an eye on. Our other numbers are really solid. This one's lagging a little bit behind, but I think that has more to do with the population than it does the actual program.
And Bill, just to reiterate what you said, historically, DLC just rolled over the numbers. There's no contact regarding if they were coming back. And this is a population you really have to engage to make sure they're coming back and that they want to come back. So what the board has received and what I received last year was, oh, we have 450 students because that was the last count. What wasn't realized is that there was no mechanism to verify those students were coming back, which is, and I don't remember, I don't know if we've done this number yet, exactly how many from who were enrolled the spring of 14 to who actually showed up on fall of 14. What percentage normally rolled over or didn't roll over. So Bill and his department took a different stab at it as we didn't have anybody in recruiting everybody. So that we had some verification of who actually was in the program. But that being said, we still have about 500 leads we're still working through.
Yeah, and if you look at the students that were with us at the end of last year that did not graduate, that's about 220. From the Berkeley program that didn't graduate, it's about 80. And then we had, again, the whole bunch of drops that we called, and we've got the people that were still interested that were working on as well. So there's just been a lot of effort put into recruitment at the TCPC this summer.
But something that has come out, I think there was an article that maybe you sent or it was shared, something about schools of choice, the mobility of schools of choice kids. And so we by far cannot count on those numbers.
No, absolutely. And you also have to look at alternative education students or a special subset of schools of choice who are even more transient than schools of choice students
so
traditionally are.
They could be popping around.
Correct. Yeah, absolutely. So if you, all that being said, if you take this all and roll it up, you add UHS, what we currently have, TCEC, what we currently have, and then Ferndale K-12, that puts us at approximately 2,633 students right now. Again, that doesn't include any drops that are going to come in. It also doesn't include the 84 K-10 applications we have and the 40 at UHS that we currently have. So there's another 120 applications we've already received that aren't included in these numbers. Just to give you a kind of frame of reference, so we're at 2,633 right now. We ended last year about mid-2,700s. So we're about 100 students behind where we were last year, but again, that doesn't include the 120 applications we've already received, as well as whatever comes in the next month, which again, we've got five more today. So it's been a constant trickle every day. So
and that's with the TCEC only at 90, as opposed to the 250 or above, you know, that we're projecting. So if you add those in, that's significantly better. Mm-hmm. And then take the, the drops out. We are cautiously optimistic that not only that we'll hit the number that we have on the budget, that hopefully we'll surpass it. I would say that we're more confident in the Ferndale K-12 number, hitting that number relatively easily. The TCEC and UHS, and the TCEC number obviously is former DLC, that number is always more difficult, but I think the enrollment in all the other programs is extremely solid, and we might buck the 10-year trend. We feel that we're on the precipice of that, of bucking the 10-year trend of each count being lower. So, but now that I've said it.
There's lots of wood to knock on. So I just want to close by saying thank you to our enrollment team. If you listen to all those numbers carefully, that's about 700 new student applications we have received this summer. So the amount of work that goes through processing, receiving, following up on, is incredible. So thank you to our staff, they do a fantastic job going through all that, so. If there's any questions?
One further clarification, just one of the unique pieces of Ferndale, so you always want to compare your district to other districts. With that number of applications in a summer, that's probably more than even the large school districts in Oakland County. So the fact that we're able to do it with the small staff that we do have within communications, you know, says a lot for the employees in that area as well as all the outreach they do. That's a very large number of application for any school district. So hats off to the department for, you know, as you know, doing more of less, but making it happen.
You're here. Yeah. Any other question?
I hope this isn't putting you on the spot, but I'm hoping you know off the top of your head. how many kindergartners do we have in Lowell?
Around 140. I can't give you a specific number, but we're about 140-ish.
So how many classes is that?
I believe right now we have 5 scheduled in one building and one in the other.
And how does that compare?
I think our kindergarten class last year was around 150. If I had to guess now, we'll be bigger than we were last year as far as kindergarten.
Because you're expecting maybe a few more.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, especially talking about new parents, or new to school, and not parents have had kids for 5, 6 years.
Right.
But traditionally, you know, you get a handful of them that it just dawns on them. For every student, every parent you have in February that's chomping at the bit to get in there, you have a handful of they go, oh crap, it's the middle of August, we got to start worrying about school. So, I would guess there's still a handful more of them.
And I guess I wanted to say that I got to go to the zoo the other night with you were there. Carl was there.
Carl's been taking it for the team. So.
And it was really great to be able to hand out. I don't know how many backpacks we handed out. We handed out the Ferndale School's yellow bags and. Like Carl calls them walking billboards. You know, it turned into sort of the Ferndale School sponsored event, and it was the Verve Pipe. So it was a very big, crowd, and I got retweeted by the Verve Pipe.
Wow.
I
did.
Yes. That was the highlight of the night.
They had like a song.
Yeah, they had a couple of hits, but they also have a fantastic family album for those of you out there with little kids. The Verve Pipe has a really good family album. Anyway, I want to just say, you know, thanks to you and your staff. I know that you've been out. Nikki and I were out face painting, and we saw you at the park Summerfest, and that was also a very well attended event. So it's good to get that all out there.
Any other questions? Thank you very much. We'll move on to the curriculum report.
We're going to take a stretch break, and we're going to walk down there so you can see some visuals, and then we'll come right back. The other updates that I wanted to share tonight, funny that I have this up here, but we have a Jumpstart program that is offered next week at Roosevelt, and we have 60-plus kindergarten students starting school next week, and they are very excited to begin. So that wasn't part of that presentation. I didn't have any photos yet, but just imagine 60 little ones in your new carpeted hallways.
Literally, jump testing,
making sure it works. So anyway, I know Bill shared some information about our Ferndale Early Childhood Center, but I'm just thrilled that we are moved over there. We are offering the Friday fun days, and the half days are built in so that the teachers within our Early Childhood Center have time to have some professional development and some days, some planning time, so that's what's built in there. We will be having a dedication ribbon cutting for our Ferndale Early Childhood Center on August 28th. We have a national early childhood speaker coming to give a one-day conference called, her name is Dr. Jean. I have about 80 participants signed up. We have 99% of our preschool through second grade teachers attending on August 28th. So
We want you guys to be there to cut the ribbon and officially open our early childhood center. They have been drastically working. I think we've had almost every teacher in there already, because preschool teachers have a lot of stuff.
Dina, so are there going to be safety scissors to cut the ribbon?
I will get a pair for you.
Don't let them run.
I will take some out of my son's room.
And they need to be the left-handed ones.
Okay. I'll make sure I have everything set.
Yes.
So we're going to give you some timelines or what time we want to do that, but we would like to make sure that we're there. Mr. Good's going to get some press there as well. Dr. Jean is a very well-known national speaker, and it'll be just the perfect way to open up our building and open up our teachers for a great school year.
So the official name of the building is Ferndale Early Childhood?
FECC, Ferndale Early Childhood Center.
What time is the ribbon cutting? Is there a time set yet?
Were you going to do it in the morning or at lunchtime?
I don't think it's been decided yet.
I'll get that to you. So very excited about that. We've been a little busy this summer. One of the things that the curriculum department did in combination with a large group of teachers is updated our district student achievement team process. The student achievement team process works a little differently in every building, but we wanted to have a more cohesive structure in place. A student achievement team process is a process where you can bring a child to a team if you have concerns over reading, writing, math, if the child is above grade level, if the child seems to have some behavioral issues or attendance issues, or you're just concerned and want another set of eyes. So we made it a little more systematic, preschool through 12th, so that everyone has a voice in that process. So the teachers worked very diligently with me, so we are excited to see that process up and running. Our building leaders have been very busy this summer. All of them attended an Oakland County Effective Practice Conference with myself for 2 days when school was over. Last week they spent 4 full days in a building leadership retreat. We had Oakland Schools, Marty Shapey, come in and work with us on balanced leadership, and we got a lot of things done just to have a collective voice as administrators. They also attended a tech summit where it was specific just for administrators on how to update your technology skills. I think next month I'll go over our Ferndale framework, which is our 4 instructional pillars, which is high quality instruction, school culture, intervention and enrichment, and assessment and results. We define what that looked like in the components of each one of those so that it is streamlined down into the schools. Every administrator has worked with their building leadership team, or they are still working with them, and have a one-page document of the school improvement plan, so it's very specific and can be part of the school's lesson plan. A few things that we're doing to promote school culture, as well as promote that whole school culture within our whole school district. Every building has a first 4 days plan so that you come together as a school family. Obviously, it would look very different at an elementary than a middle school or high school, but every school building will be dedicated the first 4 days to building a rich school culture focused on being safe and building relationships. It is each building has a very detailed laid out plan for that. We have seen that work with great success at University High School, and we felt it was very much needed in every building. So you have the UHS way, you have the FHS way, but all of that they spent quite a bit of time putting that together. So we are very excited. It might look a little different within the elementary schools, and it might not be just the first 4 days, but the first few weeks with specific activities and within the classroom and in the schools. We also have all of our school buildings working on a character day, which is going to be on September 18th. It's part of a national movement called Let It Ripple, and every building and the students' voice will decide what they do on that day to show their dedication to kindness. So they are working on that. In January, every school has signed on and committed to the greatest challenge, the Great Kindness Challenge, January 25th through 29th. So you'll see information about that. So that focus on creating that school culture, building relationships, focusing on character, and moving forward with acts of kindness has really been ingrained throughout the year with some dedicated days. On August 31st, we will be offering a one-day Schools of we will be providing a one-day Schools of Excellence conference like we did last year. Thank you to the board for already tweeting and Facebooking to get food here for the morning, and coffee. Got to remember coffee this year, even. Remind me, because you know I don't drink coffee, so I forgot the coffee last year. I won't forget the coffee this year. So that's happening. And then the school, or the building leadership teams and the principals have already focused on what they are doing for their professional development the second day. And we have those agendas. The other thing that we've been working on, and we just had a meeting earlier tonight, is updating our administrative guidelines for students with severe life-threatening allergies. So we will be working with secretaries, principals, social workers, and all school staff so that that new administrative guideline is followed from preschool through alternative ed, and being very thorough about that. We have many, many students in our school district with those allergies. So we need to build that awareness in that environment. So that's what we've been working on.
That's how it's good.
Yeah, the principal lights up.
Yeah.
I know it's not part of your presentation, but there's a lot of people out in the community that are really interested in the Cambridge program, as Mr. Good talked about how the enrollment is, you know, really super great numbers. And so I'm just wondering if you could give us a little bit of a taste of what to expect, or when the board would be able to have an update or a report on the Cambridge program.
We have met with every teacher that will be teaching Cambridge. They came and met with us for about each, like, English and language arts, math, science. They came and spent 2 to 3 days with us working on the curriculum, developing what timelines we wanted to have and what materials we needed. So they have been working on it all summer. But I will be glad to put something a little more specific together for the next board meeting with Beth and Tom here as well. And maybe some of our new teachers that are going to be teaching Cambridge. The same with Project Lead the Way. We sent Ryan Dunlop to training and are building that lab and that curriculum at this time as well. So I'll give you an update on those things.
That'd be great.
This time.
All right. Other questions? All right, then thank you very much. Next up is the Human Resources Report. Mr. Tom Shelton.
Good evening. So I really have two main things I want to talk about tonight. One is I want to give everybody an overview of where we're at with staffing currently. Excuse me. And I also want to give you an update on our transition to GCA services for our custodial maintenance services. So, you know, August is a really busy time in the Human Resources office, and we have been busy. Stricken, though, by the lack of the same number of resignations and other personnel issues that we saw last summer. There definitely seems to be a lot more stability with our employees this summer as compared to last, and I think that's a real positive thing. I've been collecting exit surveys from employees they left the last year. I'm just in the process of compiling kind of that first batch of them, so I look forward to sharing that data with you. But again, in general, the trend that I see is more stability for our staff. We're watching our numbers very, very carefully, especially at the elementary level. We were very conservative in how we set our numbers and our expectations for this year. The drops in the ads over the next 2 weeks are the big wild card and the big unknown that we just don't know what to expect. There are several grade levels where we're watching those numbers where it's possible that we may need to add staff. At this point, we have just today called back three elementary teachers who were on layoff that we're going to need to fill classes, and there's several other points where it's entirely possible that we may need to add teachers between now and August 31st. Our ultimate goal is to get fully staffed, at least for teachers, by the 31st when teachers report. That may not be necessarily practical, but we're hoping that it will be. At the secondary level, we still have one social studies and one PE teacher on layoff, and our numbers look solid and positive in the secondary level. I don't see many potential overages, and I don't see any areas where we're particularly understaffed either. I think we're in good shape at the secondary level. For TCEC, and I want to highlight something that Mindy and Sandra talked about when they made their presentation. This whole restructuring that happened at TCEC this year took a lot of great leadership from Sandra, but I think it took a lot of great leadership from our teachers in the program as well. And a lot of collaboration between us and Central Admin and the FEA. So I think what we're seeing with that program is a real testament to all those things, and that's important to mention. We are staffed right now at the TCEC program for 250 kids. We have two teachers on a layoff. Our goal would be to bring those teachers back when and if the numbers provide for that. That is our update for TCEC. With the rest of our employee groups, we have a couple of different postings, a couple of different staffing scenarios, but again, we're well on track for being fully staffed by the end of school. So, any questions about staffing before I shift gears and move on to GCA facilities? No. Okay. Our transition GCA has gone very well. We're supposed to take over services in our district on July 1st. We actually had them come in and take over a couple weeks early because most of our main employees were taking vacation time, and it was kind of like towards the end of June. So they've done a great job. It's a transition, and I think we're going to have to all remember that they're going through a process of not just getting to know our district, but also hiring their staff and becoming fully functional. They are fully staffed at this point. We have an on-site account rep. His name is Matt Newton. Excuse me. There's two of them. Eric Newton and Matt Johns. There are two. Eric Newton is our on-site guy. And he's the day-to-day facilities in the buildings every day, monitoring things, does all the hiring and firing, communicates with me and with Blake in that regard. Matt Johns is the other one that we'll see around the buildings a lot, and Matt manages several schools for Ferndale being one. But Eric Newton is our day-to-day guy. I did ask him to come here tonight. He was supposed to, but he had a family issue come up the last minute. He couldn't be here, so I haven't come to another meeting. They're doing a great job cleaning our buildings over the summer. We're well on track to have everything into top shape for the first day of school, hopefully. And again, we just Clawson just signed off on the intergovernmental agreement that we're now providing services for Clawson as well as part of that IGA board group. So and that's real positive for us because we're going to be able to share a lot of, especially the maintenance staff, with them in their areas of specialties. So we'll have, for example, say if we get a call here in the district where we needed a certified electrician to come in and perform it, where in the past we may have had to call an outside vendor to do that, we're going to be able to coordinate with cost and get somebody in at an additional cost. Lots of promising things with that IGA. Blake talked about the summer move, so I won't talk about that. And in terms of policy, I am anticipating bringing another set of NEOLA updates to Board of Governance next month. That's really the only big policy thing I see on the agenda on the horizon for us. Absolutely. And ask everybody to look at it. Okay. So, any questions, I think?
Questions? Same along the same lines as what I was asking about the security access changes. I'm wondering regarding GCA and how that's new from last year. It's going to be a change that our families, our students, our staff is going to notice right away. Is there a plan for communicating
communicating that out to the community?
It's something that I need to spend some more time with the principal, talking to the principals about.
Right, I was just going to say, or is it going to fall on the principals?
It is really going to fall on the principals, but I'm going to work with them to coordinate kind of a centralized, consistent communication.
All right, any other questions? Stop. So now we will return back to item 3.6 in the regular board meeting schedule. Amy, you have questions?
Just regarding this list of meetings that we have throughout the whole year. It's page 79 of the packet. I think December 12th maybe isn't the right, yeah, that's a Saturday. So I wanted to fix that.
You can.
Dedicated, Amy.
No, I'm going to fix it.
Yep, yes, yes.
And then...
See, that should have been 16.
Okay.
And there is no, there are no concerts or anything.
Well, and so that was my next question. I think...
We're at 16th, I'm going to go on up to 14th.
Yeah, I agree.
Look here, so sorry, I was looking at November.
I was looking through last year's schedule, and I think it was, Jim, maybe you remember, I think it was December and May were meetings that we changed because of concert conflicts.
So the numbers got flipped. It should say 21st, not 12th.
Where?
That on December. I'm just looking at the third Monday, and there are no concerts.
So that's a typo.
And we looked through the building, especially high school and middle school concerts.
Okay.
There's no concert on the 21st. There's school that day.
And
am I correct in that, Mr. Shelton?
Yeah.
When's our last day before break?
The last day before which break, I'm sorry?
For the winter break.
Let me look real quick.
Summer break.
The 18th works.
Christmas is on a Friday this year. I'm thinking that Monday.
It is Friday the 18th.
Okay. So we can move that to the Monday prior to the 14th. I have to look at the district calendar in terms of concerts. No, it would have to. It just depends on everyone's plans.
To not meet on a day that there's no school. So then, yeah, the 14th, though, but make sure there's no office.
So there's no motion on the table, so why don't we just bring this back?
Sure. Yep. We'll look at the concert
schedule. Yeah, that's fine.
Do we need to?
We've already set September.
Bring back to redo December.
And you had another one you wanted to bring up.
Just May. There was also possibility of a concert conflict that too. Just wanted, but if you've checked those, then
we checked for what we had at the time. We'll double check with the building administration. Sometimes those get changed due to building issues too.
Should we be resyncing our calendar for the next calendar year again? Those of us who are accustomed to the Google calendar.
We can send something out via communications.
Right, but that's an annual thing, is that we have to sort of re-sign up.
Correct.
Because
we're
signed up to from last year is last year.
We're working through an issue with our web provider to host a Google calendar, so hopefully that will be resolved this week.
Okay, so don't resubscribe yet.
Not yet.
Well, or if you do subscribe now, it'll kick in.
No, you'll be subscribing to last year's calendar.
We can send something out to everyone, not only the board, but the community regarding.
Yep.
So, and then we will verify the December and May meeting, and we'll look at moving the December meeting to the 14th and verify any conflict with that.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay.
Germane to the topic of meetings is our meeting location, and we had originally wanted this meeting in the auditorium opposition to meeting that, so I just wanted to put on the table the reasons why we wanted to meet in the auditorium are because of the sound and recording equipment that we already have set up there. And it does require a significant additional amount of effort from staff to get this room set up, and there's limitations with the presentation, the ability to have any more audience members than we have today in this space. So is there a significant and specific objection to meeting in the auditorium? Okay. We can either meet in the pit, which was our original plan, or on stage. The advantage of being on stage is we're more visible to people in the audience. But we're not going to have that big of a crowd. It's easier to escape.
Yeah.
It's definitely easier having observed the process. And the other thing is, everyone can be amplified in there, including us.
Correct. And we can do the presentations easily on the screen behind.
And the speakers, you know, when people come up for public comment, they'll also be amplified, so everyone will be able to hear them.
Yep.
So we'll proceed in that direction. I understand the impulse to not seem like there's a huge gulf between us and everybody's attending the meeting, but it's a better space in practical terms, which was not designed as a
meeting. You can just add it to your daily script. Explanation of why we're up there,
no.
That's not a goal.
And we're good. It won't be my script for much longer. All right, then we'll plan on that. And then we have the Eagle Points of Pride, which we need to proceed our closed session. So who wants to begin on that?
Yeah, I want to start with a very small thing, which was driving by the school and seeing not only the welcome back sign flashing and everything, but our new middle school president, Jason Gillespie, putting his personal email saying, email the principal if you have any questions, and then his email sort of slides by. And I really, the openness of that, the kind of availability of that, I thought it really sent a very nice message about who the district is. And it's really just, I mean, it's a very small example of the kind of stuff that's going on here. I really appreciate it and all the work that all the teachers and principals and administration have done here.
Amy?
I'm going to use my point of pride moment to plug the breakfast, which is coming up on August 31st, which is the at the opening day for the staff. I've started the Sign Up Genius link, so parents can go and help us, sign up to help us either provide food or drink or paper products or even just a monetary donation. And I wanted to double check with Blake about making sure we invite City Council.
So
did that last year.
Yeah.
On your list.
Yeah.
Okay.
Local officials and Representative Wissenberg. And
right. That's good. That's great for him to.
And we're going to do an email as well as a phone blast.
And also,
for all staff.
I'm open to suggestions on what our hashtag should be that day. So,
so much of school districts is about relationships, and I was just very appreciative thinking about how many coaches we have starting those relationships over the summer with their various teams. And so I just want to give a shout out to all the coaches that are out there with our kids. That's, others are up north and here with our kids.
You know, the piece that I want to point out is in Dina's presentation, adding up all the kids, all the staff members, 1,000 students that we've somehow worked with over the course of the summer. That's well over a third, getting close to a half of our K-12 population. That's amazing. I've heard Dean's department for all the teachers that helped, all the parents that helped, all the administrators. You know, many districts are just shut down in the summer, and nothing happens in the summer. People talk about year-round school. Well, here it is. That sort of commitment that we have from our parents, from our staff, from our students, and their level of involvement in that continuous education in the summer, even why we're moving three buildings, doing play groups in the early childhood center, why we're having the moving van pull in to unload everything, that takes a lot of dedication to the kids. So that's what makes our district special. So just very proud of that, all the work that all the staff members did.
I would just like to express my thanks to Tom and his team for all the work that they've done, particularly with the building, the way the buildings look. This building, I've never seen floors shine like that. You know, the state of the bathrooms is outstanding. So even with all that transition that you mentioned, it's going to be very welcoming physical space for parents and kids in a few weeks. So thank you, Tom.
And I wanted to again touch on something that Dina talked about in the presentation, and then Blake talked about too, is that the summer programs were outstanding. I had one of my kids absolutely loved the Makers Camp. He couldn't go to every one, and I couldn't go to any of them, but I heard about them tremendously, and I'm still moving stuff around that they made at the camps. And we can't get rid of, we have to keep those popcorn shakers so they can make their music. But he loved it, and what Beth put together and all the weekly updates and emails, it was outstanding. So thanks for that, for the little ones that really enjoyed it.
Is that something we have to reapply for?
Well, I wanted to really just let you all know that, one, I got a tour of the Ferndale Early Education Center, Early Childhood Center, and I was given a tour by Amy Rooney, who is the coordinator of the early childhood programs, and I'm just, the building is coming along so nicely, and it's just, it's so strange to see that where we used to have our meetings, there's going to be now this kind of this big play area for all these kids, and I'm just really glad that we've made that transition and that it's looking so favorable as far as enrollment. So thank you guys.
And also congratulations to the Jamison family on their new baby.
Yes, yeah. Rowan, I believe.
Yes.
8 pounds, 12 ounces, 26 inches.
Before we go into closed session, I'll have to go into closed session. Just want to announce the next regular board meeting is Monday, September 21st, and it will be across the hall in the auditorium at 7 o'clock. So at this time, I have a request for a closed session from the superintendent for his quarterly evaluation. So I would entertain a motion to go into closed session. This is a periodic employee evaluation, as allowed by the Open Meetings Act, upon the request of the employee, Mr. Pruitt, to be attended by the board and Mr. Pruitt. Moved by Ms. Latosh, and seconded by Ms. Lewis May. Any discussion on the motion? All right, roll call, please.
To me?
Yes.
Butters?
Yes.
Dean Krause?
Yes.
Latosh?
Yes.
May.
Yes.
And President
O'Donnell. Yes.
Thank you.
All right. So we will adjourn from regular session at 9:24, and there will be no votes or other board action taken in the closed session. We will just come in here and adjourn. Yes. Or the meeting will just